So welcome everybody to our ThinkHouse webinar this morning on dawn raids. I'm David Lowe, I'm one of the organisers of ThinkHouse, our in-house law community. And today's session comes very much from the ThinkHouse antitrust update that we did in September, where we touched briefly on dawn raids, and particularly dawn raids in the new era of emerging from COVID. And we were overwhelmed by questions, and it made us realise that there's an appetite for everyone to revisit dawn raids. So that is exactly what we're doing today. I'm very pleased to be joined by Bernardine Adkins and Sam Beighton, who are both antitrust partners in our antitrust team, and who are have just recently won competition team of the year under the Legal Business Awards. So I am truly surrounded by experts here today. Just a quick bit of housekeeping. The core session will be 45 minutes, but if you have questions to come up, then we may run on a bit longer, and it will definitely be guillotined at an hour. You can ask questions as we go along in the Q&A box, just type them in. My job as chair today will be looking out for those so that we can pick out some questions at the end, and also to use that as we go through today's session, because as you'll hear, this isn't going to be a simple PowerPoint slide where Sam's going to chalk and talk. We are going to try this to turn this into a much more of a conversation to try and help you digest a lot of information, particularly as we need to tackle that at pace. After today's session, you will all get a copy of the handout, the slides, and you will also get a copy of the recording, which you can watch again if you love the sight of Sam and Bernardine. You can repeat that experience, but more importantly, perhaps share that with members of your teams if you think that would be useful. So today we're going to be talking about dawn raids, and this is the kind of territory we're going to cover. Back to basic, what is a dawn raid? Can you have a lawyer present? What powers do the CMA have? What limits? What about self-incrimination? What happens if somebody raids you today and then the CMA raids you today and somebody hides the evidence? And then also, how's the world changed? The world has changed, but how's that impacted dawn raids and CMA investigations? Now, to get the juices flowing and get you engaged, we thought we were going to open with a quick pop quiz to help you think about dawn raids. And I'm conscious that you're not going to have a warning of a dawn raid about to happen. These are questions you might have to answer in real time, as we are doing today. So we have got a couple of scenarios, and I'm going to read the first one, and a quiz will come up. So the first one I wanted to think about is, the CMA is conducting a dawn raid at the company's offices today. Which of the following items which are on or in your desk could the CMA officers review? Could they look at your laptop, your work laptop, your work mobile, your work notepad? What about your personal mobile, which you've used for a work WhatsApp group? And what about that personal diary that you've got, hard copy on a personal phone maybe, which you don't use for work? What do you think? Are you obliged to provide all or any of those to that? Our second question is, an officer in your company, CMA officer, sorry, sees an appointment in your calendar that you offer a round of golf. Yeah, that's a red flag, isn't it, for a dodgy cartel meeting. The appointment was meant for a member of the sales team who's recently left the company, and it was sent to you by mistake. And you explain this to the officer, who asked if the sales member went to the meeting. You know that they did. But as the question relates to a former employee, can you refuse to answer on this basis? Great, I'm seeing lots of people answering the poll. Yeah, people, diary, personal diary, maybe, maybe not. Maybe not personal mobile. And then the final scenario here today is towards the end of the day, the CMA have been in the offices doing the dawn raid all day. A colleague finds a stack of files in a box. Then you know the files belong to that ex-sales team member, you know, the one that went off for the round of golf. In that box, there's a number of highly confidential documents that shouldn't be made public. And the CMA officers believe the files are relevant to the investigation and want to make copies. Can you, as the in-house lawyer, quickly check the files, take out these highly confidential documents before the CMA makes copies? So let's just see how we're getting on with the polling. So I think General consensus is work laptop, work mobile, work notepads definitely could be taken. Some debate about whether your personal mobile and personal diary can be taken, especially the diary, which has no work content. We've got the question about, can you refuse to answer the CMA about the person playing golf, about whether he actually went? Most of you think no, but there's some who go, yes, you could refuse that. And then on the shred, the files to be shredded, can you remove any conflict information? Most people think you can't, but some people think you can. So you know, there is some debate there, and you will learn today what is the actual answers to all of those questions. And I'm going to share those results to you all. So turning on then to our first area, back to basics. Sam, Bernardine, what is a door note? When do these take place?
Thanks, David. I'll pick this up. So dawn raid sounds incredibly dramatic, and of course it is, but the dawn part is actually somewhat misleading, because dawn raids, as you'll be aware, they normally take place shortly after the start of the working day, so usually between say 9 and 10 on a working day. As for the raid part, the raid is the CMA entering premises to exercise its statutory information gathering powers. And in this context, the CMA is able to enter both business premises, and as we will see, it can also enter domestic premises. In terms of the information gathering powers that have been exercised, the reason for this is because the CMA has already opened an investigation. So as Bernardine will explore in more detail, whereas for the company, this is the first stage, this is the start of something new. For the CMA, this is the next phase of a process that's already started. So they are there because they have a reason to be there in their minds. And in terms of the investigations, when we're thinking about CMA investigations, we are thinking about either a civil investigation or a criminal investigation. And I will explore those in a little bit more detail now. So in relation to a civil investigation, what we see here is where the CMA has reasonable grounds for suspecting an infringement of the UK competition law, it may decide to exercise its powers in relation to dawn raids to preserve and obtain evidence of that suspected infringement. Now, for some types of infringement, the CMA won't use a dawn raid. It will use different information gathering powers. However, if the CMA is looking at things that are clandestine, secretive, typically cartels between competitors, then you would expect the CMA to be coming in and using those powers under dawn raid provisions to preserve and obtain what may be limited evidence in the circumstances. Now, in the context of a civil investigation, it is the businesses that are under investigation, it is not the individuals. That said, though, there are still implications for individuals arising from civil investigations. We've listed some of the risks here for businesses, obviously fines, you'll be well aware of those, claims for damages, but also individuals now increasingly face the risk of being disqualified from acting as directors, and that can be for a period of up to 15 years. We will be focusing today upon the CMA, but I think it is worth just flagging at this stage that other sector authorities can conduct dawn raids in relation to civil investigations. So Ofgem, for example, Financial Conduct Authority, Civil Aviation Authority, to name but a few. So there are those concurrent powers that sector authorities have, but in the interest of time today, we are focusing upon CMA. Thinking then in relation to criminal investigations. So both the CMA and the Serious Fraud Office can investigate individuals in relation to the criminal cartel offence. Now, subject to certain limited exceptions, an offence is committed in this context if at least two individuals agree that at least two competing businesses, i.e. businesses at the same level of supply chain, will engage in prohibited cartel arrangements. Those would be the hardcore cartel activities, so price fixing, market sharing, bid rigging, limiting output. So that is the cartel offence. Both CMA and SFO can investigate. For individuals, this is a high price to pay. There is the risk of up to 5 years imprisonment and or an unlimited fine, and also the application of the Proceeds of Crime Act. So if someone is found guilty under the cartel offence, their personal assets may also be confiscated. However, so far, criminal prosecutions have been comparatively rare. So since 2003, there have been three cases that resulted in five convictions. All of those were guilty pleas. In 2015, just around the corner from the Crown Court, we had the first completed criminal trial.
both individuals who stood trial were actually acquitted, they found not guilty, walked free from court. For the CMA, this was seen as a loss, and following that loss, there was a general reluctance to proceed with criminal prosecutions. Instead, the CMA shifted its focus to directors' qualifications to emphasise personal liability. So does that mean the cartel offence is back on the shelf with dust gathering upon that? I'm afraid that's not the case, because we've seen a memorandum of understanding entered into by the CMA and the Serious Fraud Office in 2020 outlined the possibility of greater cooperation, which suggests a re-engagement with pursuing criminal cartel investigations. So we don't have the time, unfortunately, in today's session to cover all of criminal investigations, but I think it is worth flagging that where there is a civil investigation, it cannot be ruled out that couldn't then become a gateway for a criminal investigation, or there may still be standalone criminal investigations that we see emerging in the future. But as I said before, this for the CMA is another stage in a process. However, for the company, it is the start of something new. And I'll hand over to Bernardine to discuss those points.
Thank you, Sam. Yeah, I think it's important to be aware, and this I think does colour how one should manage a drone raid, the discrepancy as between the CMA and a company. And so it bears on to, frankly, inequality of arms. So on the one hand, at the start of a drone raid, the CMA will have a whole host of information. Either would have had a complaint, or more likely, a leniency application, a whistleblower. It may go so far as, for example, in the galvanised steel water tanks case, actually they already would have had video evidence of a cartel meeting. Or alternatively, and we're likely to see this is the case, own intelligence. The CMA has its own intelligence unit now. We'll be looking at figures and saying we don't like what's happening in this particular market. There seems to be prices are going up very much in the same sort of way. Something suspicious is going on here. And as people are making, we're seeing fewer leniency applications as people are concerned about damages, the CMA is placing more reliance upon own intelligence. And so the CMA will have spent many, many weeks sifting through evidence. It will have obtained a warrant from the High Court in certain circumstances, which is a high burden to traverse. They will have briefed the staff. There can be quite a few staff. They will be all pumped up with adrenaline, excited to get moving. They will have spent the night before at a premier inn, be all ready to go over 2 days. They'll have hired a van. Be there early in the morning. They will have instructed external IT consultants to use the forensic software to mirror laptops and telephones, and then contrast the poor business, which will have a very, very different set of preparedness. And it will be a whole spectrum. From on the one hand, you'll have some businesses which will have a lovely, beautiful internal policies and procedures. In an ideal world, there'll be clear, simple instructions and staff will know exactly what to do. On the alternative, they actually could be a very, very complex manual, and staff, quite frankly, simply don't have the time to review those procedures. The other side of the spectrum is some people have nothing in place. And life being as it is, often the very people that you are relying upon to manage a drone raid may not be there that day. Plus, we've seen that the CMA tends to look at companies' house in terms of who they name on the warrant or the authorization. And often the person named in company house simply often isn't at the office. And so the people who would be there to manage it are simply not named or asked for. And the receptionist, it might be a temporary receptionist that day, it may happen that day. And so there can be quite a bit of chaos, certainly in the initial start of a drone raid, with that discrepancy as between the CMA, as I said, pumped up, tooled up, ready to move straight away, because it's there because it thinks something quite serious and illegal has taken place, it has evidence and it wants to get moving, whereas the business often is in a state of complete confusion.
So, okay, so at least the drone raid is not at dawn, but you've explained how they've got lots of powers. There might be civil and there might be criminal, and you would be worrying and wondering about that. And I think, Bernie, you made that really good point that they're really tooled up. But hang on, I'm just thinking for the in-house lawyers listening to this. I mean, surely the business has the right to say, hang on, we need to get our lawyers here. Please, CMA, please wait at the door while we sort out our lawyers and get ourselves ready for this. Surely?
No. Frankly, there is no right for a lawyer to be present during a drone raid. Yes, you can request under the CMA rules. You say, yes, you can request. And in principle, the CMA may wait a reasonable time and it may ask for certain undertakings. So, for example, to prevent destruction of evidence. But quite frankly, that's a textbook answer. The reality is they are unlikely to wait, simply because the reason they have opted for a drone raid and to dedicate those scarce resources to having 12 people or so out of the office for 2 to 3 days is because they suspect that there is a danger of destruction of evidence. And so they will not sit chastely in reception while you're waiting to get hold of an external lawyer or get the in-house lawyer on the premises. So in practice, businesses need to move very fast. Don't try and delay things by giving a health and safety lecture, for example. See if you can agree a delay. Expect, though, that you are very, very unlikely to get a delay. What we tend to find works well in practice is, as in-house counsel, first of all, know beforehand how your IT works. Is your IT mirrored and basically is it recorded overnight? So are you able to reassure the CMA, essentially putting it crudely, you've secured the crime scene? Are you able to say, reassure them, I've spoken to IT, we've got a picture of what was happened as of midnight last night, that has now been preserved. Please, can you give me an hour while we get external counsel on site? So that is something you can try and do, is give them concrete evidence of how you actually have secured the scene. And usually once they know that they've got a secured scene, they tend to try and relax, because otherwise they are very, very keen to get moving, because in their minds, somebody is standing over a shredder, shredding documents.
So what power, so at the moment, we are getting some questions about the domestic situation. Just a flag, we are going to, we're covering business premises first, and then we're going to get to domestic premises, because obviously they're really important, why many of you are listening today, but we wanted to set the baseline first before we got to that. So turning to what powers the CMA has, are they like the police? Can they just sort of crash and burn, so to speak?
Okay, so focusing, as you say, David, on business premises and thinking about civil investigations. So what the CMA can do in terms of entering business premises, in our experience, what we have found is that, you know, typically, depending on premises and the size and the layouts, etc., you're normally looking at least 2 to 3 days in terms of the dorm rate. That's sort of typical duration. So these things aren't quick things. It's not like lightning striking. This does take some time. So they are there for some time in your office. You're effectively hosting them. The powers that they have will vary depending upon what is being used to conduct the dorm raid. So it may be conducted under a warrant, or it may be conducted under an authorization from the CMA itself. These are quite important distinctions, and for a business being investigated, it's critical to know what you're dealing with, because as we'll see, the powers differ between the two. So just starting off with a warrant, which is the most far-reaching in terms of powers available to investigating officers. So under a warrant, it is possible for the officers to use reasonable force to enter if necessary, not against the person, but against, I suppose, premises, one's better expression. So they can use reasonable force to enter. I'm not aware of that happening in anything that we've worked on in previous cases, but it exists as a power. I think the most important power in this bullet point, though, is this ability to actively search the premises. So the officers can turn up, they can start going through filing cabinets, they can start going through, you know, laptops, emails, etc. They can actively search the premises. They can also require individuals to give explanations of relevant documents, and also to state where relevant documents may be found. And obviously for the CMA coming into an office, that's really important that they can ask people, because otherwise they'll be there for much longer than 2 or 3 days. If they have to go through everything by themselves, they can ask people, can you show me where X is? And then that person is required to go and show them, you know, where that cache of documents may be found. In addition, they can conduct compulsory interviews, and we will touch upon this a little bit later on, where individuals in the context of a compulsory interview are required to answer the questions put to them by the CMA. They are also able to remove documents for later review to determine their relevance, so-called seize and sift powers. And this may come about where the investigating officers believe, have reasonable grounds to believe, that perhaps a box of documents is relevant to the investigation. They don't have time at that stage. It's not reasonably practical at that stage to actually go through that box on the premises and work out what is and what isn't relevant. So under seize and sift powers, they could take that whole box of original documentation with them and do that review process in detail off the site. They're also able to copy relevant documents, take extracts, and remove relevant documents to preserve them. And in addition, they can use whatever means is reasonably necessary, in effect, to prevent interference with relevant documentation. And we commonly see this where, as I mentioned, a dorm raid at business premises may go on for 2 to 3 days. It's not unusual for the CMA, every time it leaves at the end of day one or day two, to seal parts of the premises it has not yet got onto looking at
to ensure that whatever is in those parts, perhaps it's a filing cabinet, perhaps it's a server in an archive room, isn't then subject to interference in that intervening overnight period. And finally, the CMA is able to require that documents or information that's stored electronically is made available in a form that can be read and removed. So not taking original copies, but effectively taking copies of whatever may be on electronic devices, again, to go and review those documents that have been stored electronically to determine their relevance after the actual dawn raid itself. So that's under a warrant. And just moving on then to think about an authorization. What I've tried to do here is just make this hopefully kind of user-friendly in terms of ease of reading by just striking out things that drop out when we start thinking about authorization. So under authorization, the key aspect we lose is this ability to actively search. That means that individuals are instead required to produce relevant documentation. So rather than officers themselves going and searching, they can ask individuals, can you go, not show me where it is, go and get it for me, bring it to me, and then your turn pages for me, let's go through this on this documentation. So they have that power. Seize and sift falls away under authorization, so they do not have that power under authorization to gather up originals and to take them off the premises in that way. So those kind of key powers, they do fall out. However, the officers still have a lot of powers available under authorization. Just to pick up, so they can still conduct compulsory interviews, they can still seal the premises, and again, really importantly, they can still require that electronic copies are made of documentation stored electronically. And just to give a recent example of a case in which we saw the relevance of electronic documents, electronic devices, roofing materials, which is an investigation into a suspected infringement with competitors engaging in anti-competitive practices. What we saw there was a director using their personal mobile to initiate and maintain contact with competitors. And they actually began doing this after a competition or compliance course. I mean, who says you learn nothing on these things? That was a clear takeaway, was switch to personal mobile. So on the back of that, the officers requested the director's mobile during a dawn raid. Once they had that, they then forensically analysed that. So that included recovering deleted text messages. So things that people may think they've lost, what we have learned over the years is it's actually very difficult to destroy things electronically. It's very, very hard to do. So this was put through forensic analysis, various things recovered, and the evidence obtained contributed to a finding of an infringement. Now, the company itself was fined just over £8 million for that infringement. But as I mentioned before, with individual liability, the individual was then disqualified from acting as director for 6.5 years on the back of that infringement.
So Sam, just thinking back to the poll we asked at the beginning, when the golf club appointment that's in your diary wrongly about the previous employee, I think what I'm hearing is if they ask you a question about it and you know the answer, you must answer it.
I question the fact. Yeah, question of fact. Basically, did that person attend that meeting? You know, they did, then you should be answering that question. It's a factual statement, you're confirming.
Right. And actually, kind of question is, someone said, if you're a shadower, so the person shadowing the CMA team, and you're asked by the CMA team where a certain document is held, but you genuinely do not know, would that be accepted?
If you don't know, you don't. You can't start formulating ideas that you don't have. So yeah, if you don't know, I think that's perfectly valid to say, I don't know, perhaps the reason I'm not usually in this team, I'm on this floor for the first time, I'm here shadowing, but this person perhaps may know. If you want to cooperate in that way, to be seen to cooperate, my sense would be that they, if they're looking for those documents, they will find them. And if you don't know where they are, you can certainly say that.
They're going to ask who will know.
That may be the next question.
Yeah. If you know, you need to answer. Yeah. Understood. Great. So so that was obviously all about this traditional dawn raid, business premises, which hasn't really changed with COVID, of course, except that many people haven't been in their business premises for the last couple of years. When we did this back in September, the big area of interest was about people's homes. We're all working from home, we have been working from home. We've got documents and laptops at home. Our senior executive teams are all at home with piles of paper at home. What are the CMA powers about coming in your house?
Sure. David, they're pretty extensive. Historically, the ability for the CMA to and other authorities to enter into domestic premises was a bit of a rump end of their investigative powers, but now they are very, very real. The only small comfort in this is that they must be conducted under warrant. So the CMA will not go into somebody's home lightly, that's for sure. But they could certainly enter domestic premises. which are premises that are used as a dwelling in connection with the affairs of an undertaking, or where documents are kept. So if you're bringing home your work diary or mobile, your work mobile, or even your personal mobile, which is used in work, it is very, very simple and easy for the CMA to be able to establish this is appropriate for us to raid these particular premises. And so when the CMA is raiding, one, it's able to use reasonable force, and reasonable force can actually involve knocking the front door down, quite frankly. And also it can actively search. Contrast warrants with a business, it doesn't have the ability to seize and assist. In other words, it doesn't have the ability to empty your study out and take the originals away. It can only take copies of the study. But it can also require individuals to give explanations of relevant documents. As Sam said, a question of factors, is this your handwriting? What does that say? I can't read the handwriting. Also compulsory interviews as well. I have to say though, I do question what probative value a compulsory interview would be under those circumstances. Somebody being suddenly raided at home and questioned. They can take copies of documents, which can include, and we've seen this in the past where the Commission, CMA, sorry, has raided homes. They do take mirrors of people's SIM card, essentially, see who they've been texting and calling. And also they can seal parts of premises. So it's imperative people are aware that if they do, seal off a study, they really overnight should not open that seal. Otherwise they'll be in considerable trouble. And basically required certain documents to be made available. So this is very real. The CMA have used these powers in the past, and we anticipate they're going to be using them more. So one of the first things, a practical point for in-house counsel to consider in the initial shock and confusion of a dawn raid is think who's not showing up, who's not reported in, who at top level, sales level, are we not hearing from? Because you may find that there may be 12 people who've turned up at their front doorstep, and they may well have turned up earlier than the 8:30 to 9:30 quote unquote dawn raid, and they're already absolutely submerged under a CMA investigation. So that's a really important practical point, is think outside the box in terms of, yes, we're being raided right now, is somebody else's home in parallel being raided as well? So looking to the future, the CMA wants, the government is considering actually enhancing these powers to include a cease and desist, which would be basically seizing the originals instead of taking mirror copies of laptops and mobiles, actually taking the originals. So that joy is to come possibly.
So the CMA has the power to, if they get a warrant, to come in the house and look at your documents and all that kind of stuff. Do they really? I mean, there's one thing about what powers have, but have they actually been raiding people's houses?
Yes, they have, absolutely. Yeah, and we anticipate it happening more.
Yeah, is that a new COVID thing, or were they raiding people's houses pre-COVID?
They were. I mean, in fact, since the inception of the Competition Act, it was a possibility. Then actually 2004, they made it harder to raid in so far as they said, you must have a warrant. So in other words, you have to go before the High Court with evidence, convince a judge, look, we've got reasonable reason to believe that there is this illegal act has happened and there's a possibility of destruction. So it's a high burden, but the CMA has been using those powers pre-COVID. And we now anticipate some raids in this area. We haven't seen them yet. The European Commission has started raiding, and apparently under COVID secure circumstances, I envisage they're all wearing masks. So we envisage this should start soon.
Right, okay. So this isn't new, but it's just becoming more apparent, and there's a higher risk the CMA is going to be in people's homes because they know that there's stuff at people's homes now because people have been working at home.
I think that's right. I think it raises the temperature for certain individuals. The fact we haven't been working at home for 18 months, even if the definition of domestic premises, there must be millions of homes in the country now that fall in that category, which before perhaps was a bit borderline. Now they clearly will do. So I think there is that additional risk, and it's something for the companies to, I think, just bear in mind in terms of not everyone will be subject to this, not everyone would have the risk of their home being subject to a dawn raid, but it's definitely something to factor into to training, to giving the messaging to key people about this is what you need to do, be aware of this. And we've been touching this later on in terms of thinking about how you equip people if the worst case that was to happen, given that heightened risk in the circumstances we face.
Now, it might not surprise you, Sam, I think we're getting flooded with questions, so let me just pick up some of them because I think it's really good to ask them as the in the heat of the talk, isn't it? What happens if they raided the FD's house, but the FD's not at home and it's just his wife and kids or husband and kids at home? Do they have to wait for the FD to be there, or can they come in?
No, it's the premises I'm interested in. The person in question doesn't have to be there. It's entry into the premises to take copies of the documentation that is there.
Yeah.
And one of the questions is absolutely, they can not just look at them at work mobile, they will have the forensics, the IT forensics, the software, and they will basically take a copy of it. And yeah. they will do the same for laptop, they'll take a copy of it.
And if we're being really, really sort of blunt about it, in terms of the power legislation gives, there could be no one at the premises. And as long as they've tried to make contact with someone and they couldn't do it, they could still go into empty premises because the warrant relates to the premises. It's not about having someone there to be overseeing or invigilating the dawn raid. They have information gathering powers and they have the ability under the statute to exercise those.
Yeah. And reasonable force will include breaking the door.
So, yeah, so the message will be in refreshing your dawn raid manual is to and remind certainly the senior executives that it's possible they could be raided at home, that they are entitled to ask for the warrant, but if there is a warrant, they have to stand aside and let them in. And actually, it might be sensible for them to tell other people they live with, just in case they're not in at the time, to be aware this could happen. That's the, what I'm hearing, I think.
It's a balance. I certainly wouldn't tell every single member of staff, you can be raided at home. I think that would panic people and they'd be frightened to do their day job. So I think it's a careful balance. You basically make this compliant, sensitive people aware of this, rather than everybody in the business.
Yeah, somebody's asked, you know, would it be reasonable to assume that dawn raids of domestic premises are limited or geared towards the directors?
I think that's a reasonable starting point. I think you can also pull into that category, as Bernie said, the higher risk people, so people who are perhaps heading sales teams, who've got that more kind of competitor contact type role in the organisation. In terms of in cases that we've been involved in, and you know, cases on the public record, I'd say it's tilted more in terms of proportionality, that there are more directors who perhaps have their domestic premises inspected, but it's certainly not just directors. So it would also be sort of key people in sort of leadership teams, sales roles, people who've got that competitor facing role would be sort of more than norm as well.
So it's worth, if any in-house law is responsible for drawing together the dawn raid premises, it ought to be stopping and thinking, who are the high-risk people? Yeah. Directors, obviously, but there's a bunch of other people, I mustn't forget, who are in that sort of senior roles. Okay.
But as Bernie said, I think the message now is key, because if they're telling everyone across the business, you know, be aware you might have your front door knocked, that, I think, would perhaps make some people very nervous about what they're actually doing their day jobs, kind of undermine their confidence to actually do the day-to-day role. May also make people kind of question what the business is actually doing if you have this kind of widespread message at any point in your door could be not by the CMA. So I think it is a question of, as Ben said, having that balance, looking at who, by reference to your own business, would be a high-risk individual, for want of a better expression, and making sure that they then have the know-how that if you know, the worst case did happen, that they were equipped to deal with that as best they could.
Now, on that point about, as in house law, if you're being raided at the business premises, be aware, you mentioned, be aware who's not in and might be being raided at home. Can you ask the CMA if they're raiding anyone at home? And if you, well, presume you can, but will they be prepared to answer that question?
You can ask, but they won't tell you. You can ask.
Right, so
they're not there to make your life easier.
Right, okay, which is why you've then got to be proactively...
Assume the worst.
And can the person who's at home being raided, is he allowed or she allowed to call into the office to say, help, I'm being raided?
I think there's no such thing as allowed, but I think it would be a very, very reasonable request. And to be quite forceful in terms of saying, this is a reasonable request, I need to do this. And the CMA, they want to facilitate this happening, and also they will be very conscious that this is an individual. So that I think they're likely to facilitate that.
Yeah, so they're not going to be really nasty to the person, but they will be aware that they're entering somebody's home in order to have some level of respect and courtesy. Yeah. Somebody's asked about the old chestnut about cars. You know, the sales director's gone and put all the files on the cars. Where does that fit into all this?
Yeah, the definition of land includes, the definition of premises includes land and or means of transport. And not a lot of people know this, but those rules are actually taken from the Italian black market rules devised in World War II. and it's funny because we were discussing this earlier, because the commission always make a big, big point of saying we have the power to look at vehicles. And they always make a point, everyone has to trot out to the car park and inspect someone's boot. But it's a common thing, you know, people panic. And a car boot to sling the files is actually quite a good place to hide stuff. So it's not surprising that there is that ability.
Somebody's asked about dawn raids. Normally they happen, as we talked about, on a business day, but can they happen at the weekend?
I've never heard of that. Also, they curiously, we've noticed they usually happen on a Tuesday. Monday to get everyone tooled up and prepared, Tuesday to go in. So that's our anchor day as a team. We're always in one place on a Tuesday.
I know this is the last one I'm going to do. I can't answer all this, but there's one I quite enjoyed. Is somebody said, have in-house laws been specifically targeted based on past experiences to be rated at home? Are they seen as by the CMA as a high-risk useful person?
No, I've never come across in-house law being targeted. And one of the reasons for that is because we'll touch upon some of these limits, but the whole point around legal privilege as in-house lawyer, perhaps little that you would necessarily have. You have obviously various professional commitments, you have a regulated profession. I don't think this is high risk from CMA's perspective in terms of competition or infringement.
No, I think they'd have to have some really, really good evidence to go into an in-house lawyer's house, because so much of it would be privileged. So in-house lawyers do get privileged.
So probably the in-house lawyer job on the day is running around managing the decision and everything else. I won't hopefully be able to worry about whether their studies being rendered, which is at least that helps focus. Okay. So I'm sorry to those who haven't asked all the questions, but there was obviously a lot there. We've talked about their very extensive powers at home and business practices. What are the limits to their powers?
Okay, so the first kind of wraparound limit is going to be the scope of the warrant authorisation, and that is going to be setting out really what the suspected infringement is in high-level terms. So if the infringement is suspected in relation to product X, then any searches, questions, should it really be around product X? It's not a fishing expedition here. They stay focused in terms of the parameters of the investigation, the premises. So if they have delineated in a warrant reauthorization premises which are not the ones they're at, then clearly that's the wrong place for them. They haven't got authorization to be there. They shouldn't be conducting the warrant. You shouldn't be engaging on that basis. Personnel, so the warrant will list individuals who are unable to be present on the day from the CMA's perspective. If there are additional people there, people who are not named on there, then again, they don't have authority to be, they shouldn't be there. So that scope of the warrant authorization initially wraps around the framework that the CMA can work to. Outside of that, we have legal privilege. So a business cannot be required to disclose communications which in proceedings in the High Court would benefit from legal professional privilege. And if there is a dispute as to whether something attracts LPP, then what you'd normally seek to do is just keep those documents separate. And normally they'd be sealed in perhaps an envelope or into a box and all taped up. And you put them to one side pending resolution as to whether or not those documents actually are covered by legal professional privilege. And I think just as a point of good order in any event for businesses, keeping your legally privileged documentation clearly separate, both within your electronic filing and also your physical filing. It's just a good habit to be. And we've done mock dorm raids before. We've gone into people's offices and we've found our own legal advice on top of filing cabinets just lying around. So I think it's just a good idea in any event, just to have an idea of where your safe place is for your legally privileged documentation. And the last limit in these circumstances will be self-incrimination. So a business cannot be required to answer questions that would mean admitting infringing UK competition law. So the CMA can ask questions of fact, as we touched upon, did you attend, did that person attend the meeting? But couldn't ask questions around, did you engage in price fixing at that meeting? Did you engage in market share at that meeting? Because to answer those questions would then move into that frame of admitting infringement of competition law. So those are some of the key protections there.
So I'm just getting my head around that. The fact on the one hand, you can't be obliged to self-incriminate yourself. On the other hand, you've got to answer compulsory interview. And maybe I've watched too many US police dramas, but is it a bit like, I'm going to plead the fifth and not answer any questions at all? Is that how it works?
It's a really good question. And it's quite, I think from our perspective, it's quite an interesting issue in terms of how this actually unfolds in practice, because we talked earlier about these compulsory interviews. And as mentioned, what these enable an officer to do is, provided they've given formal notice, they can compel an individual with connection with the business investigation to answer certain questions. And going to your point, David, can you plead the fifth? Can you do, I'm thinking about the bill in terms of no comment interviews. There is no right to remain silent in these circumstances. So you can be compelled to answer questions. In terms of who can be compelled to answer questions, this notion of connection with, essentially, it means an individual who is or was concerned in the management or control of the business under investigation or employed by or otherwise working for the business. Now, obviously, that would include things like current directors, former employees, but interesting in CMA's guidance, they also extend that to professional advisors. So you could find, and this wouldn't perhaps happen in the context of doormaid in your premises, but you could find your professional advisors are also being asked questions under these powers and being compelled to answer questions. In terms of what you can do in this context, once you receive the formal notice, this is going to set out for you what the investigation subject matter is, where and when the questions will be asked, and in theory, that notice could say they will be asked immediately after you've received this notice. It will also set out the fines that can be imposed. These are fines that can be imposed upon an individual if they fail to answer questions under the notice. And what the notice will also do will make clear that there are limits on the use of answers given by the individual in criminal prosecutions. What can't happen in the context of a Section 26A interview, as they're known, is you can't have a situation where you are being compelled to disclose communications that attract legal privilege. So that's one thing that cannot happen in terms of questioning. Individuals in these circumstances, they can ask to have a lawyer present when they're questioned, and they may be represented by a lawyer who is also representing the business. So you could have a situation, if everyone can square the conflicts away, that the legal team representing the business may also then act for an individual who is being questioned under these powers. But what the CMA is really reluctant to have happen is that for lawyers representing only the business get to sit in on these compulsory interviews, because their concern there is that if you, as the individual, you've got your impact of your employer's lawyers sat in the room eyeballing you, that may make you more reluctant to answer these questions as freely as you would otherwise. And thinking about self-incrimination, this is an area which I think there is room for discussion and debate going forwards in this. But what we have seen so far is, as mentioned, the notice sets out clear limits on how answers an individual may give can be used against them in criminal prosecutions. And from the CMA's perspective, we have a couple of procedural officer decisions which set out what appears to be the CMA's approach to this, which is that if you are being questioned and you're giving answers, it is you as an individual answering questions. You don't have a right in terms of privilege of self-incrimination, because the answers you're being given, they can't really be used against you in criminal prosecutions. You're not under a cartel offence interview here. And the fact that these answers could be used against you in direct disqualification proceedings, that's different from CMA's perspective. They say, well, actually, that's not a criminal prosecution. So self-incrimination doesn't really apply in these circumstances. You do have to answer questions, and the incrimination, you're protected from self-incrimination by virtue of the limited use in criminal prosecutions. Direct disqualification proceedings, they're not criminal, and therefore answers you give can be used in that context against you as an individual in direct disqualification. So we haven't really seen this tested thoroughly, but to my mind, it's something which I think there is a natural tension there in terms of how this information can be used, particularly when direct disqualification has such an impact on individuals. So to my mind, this is perhaps a debate that may evolve as time goes on.
And Sam, is the compulsory interview, is that likely to happen on the day of the dawn raid, or is the dawn raid a sort of document, an information gathering moment? Yeah. Followed by the interviews.
That's a really good question, David. So we haven't seen ourselves compulsory interviews taking place during dawn raids. I'm not aware from anything that's been made public by the CMA that they have happened. It is a power that is on the statute books. We have had instances of them happening after the dawn raid, where the investigating authority has dug deeper into documentation and has set up a compulsory interview to compel answers to certain questions. Given that this does exist as a power, what we would suggest is that if you had an officer who was looking to conduct a compulsory interview during a dawn raid, what you try and do is to agree this takes place at a later date. And I think a key facet of that is making sure the individual can access appropriate legal representation. I think it's also an evidential question as well, as how the quality of that evidence, how good will that be, how robust will that be if someone is actually in a state of shock, panic, under extreme stress during a dawn raid that's just unfolding in front of them, you know, what the quality answers will be. I think it's also just worth noting at this point that the government is currently considering broadening compulsory interview powers. So as I mentioned before, this idea of a connection with, that was quite limited, just focusing upon the business under investigation. the government's thinking about broadening these powers out. So this could cover things like customers, suppliers, so people who have a wider relationship with the business. Those individuals could also be required to submit to compulsory interviews. So to my mind, this is an area we will see, I think, more activity, which may prompt more questions about how this should be applied and whether there should be any additional safeguards for individuals in these circumstances.
Okay, obviously there's always somebody, isn't there, who the dawn raid happens and they're quickly running off the files, burning them, putting them in their cars, all that kind of stuff. The classic naughty person who goes and hides stuff. What happens on that?
You're absolutely right, David. It's certainly our experience, and it's worn out by the decisional practice. Invariably, somebody panics and does something silly with evidence. So practically speaking, presume somebody is going to conceal or destroy evidence. So the role of in-house counsel is to make sure that doesn't happen. Because what happens if that person, if that does happen? So in principle, it's a criminal offence for an individual to destroy, conceal, hide a document or ask somebody else to do it, or obstruction officer in the exercise of their powers, or be economical with the truth, so to speak. Also, so that's from an individual perspective. Also, in principle, an individual could be fined up to £30,000, also £15,000 a day for every day they're in default producing documentation. And then from a business perspective, the CMA can also fine a business for failing to, you know, to disgorge information or destroying information. And we saw a case, the Fender case, which is, those of you with teenagers at home, which is concerned with guitars, or people with teenage mindsets, perhaps. So under the Section 27 authorisation, the company was required to give over certain documentation. Day two, the officer reminded Fender, we've asked for notebooks of this individual. So some notebooks were given over. A senior individual said, well, here's my diary and a notebook. But I was destroying my old notebooks and I just carry over what's of interest, so nothing to see there. And that was the CMA's understanding, that those notebooks had been destroyed. 3 weeks later, 10 additional notebooks were given to the CMA. And this came out to the ether. So the company heard through the casual remark that there were these extra notebooks. The senior individual had asked a junior, please, can you hide these? And they'd taken them home, and it was only because of a passing remark that the business became aware of these documents. And of course, the business quite properly gave it to their lawyers, who then gave it to the CMA. So Fender was fined £25,000, notwithstanding that Fender said, well, hang on, this was a rogue employee. We were cooperating, the business was cooperating. This was completely out with of what we wanted that employee to do. We, the company, should not be on the hook for that. And the CMA was having none of it. It said, no, you're on the hook for this because that was your employee. You're responsible for everything they do. And that will include the willful destruction of evidence, you know, arguably in the face of instructions to the contrary. And so you could say, well, £25,000, that's not so bad. That's true. Because, as I said, there's a flat rate for companies of 30 grand a day, sorry, 15 grand a day plus a flat rate of £30,000 compared to the millions of a cartel ultimate fine. And so the government is aware of this. We're out of sync with the rest of other regulators throughout the world. So the CMA wishes to up the ante of that. So whereby you have 1% of turnover, global turnover per of a fixed fine, then 5% per day, et cetera, et cetera. So give it some real, real teeth. So what we're observing here is, and some of my findings are always quite extraordinary, sometimes they're quite egregious breaches in terms of destruction of evidence by an individual. And we saw, and this is on the public record, in the galvanised steel jury trial, an individual said, yes, in my diary, I knew there was a cartel meeting the next day. I always noted the instructions I was going to give to the MD in terms of what was happening. That would have been the most beautiful piece of evidence or a piece for the business to give to the CMA, and just, and I destroyed it. No repercussions for that individual. So ironically, in principle, it's a criminal act, but what we're seeing happening in reality, it's the companies are on the hook for this. So query, what should a company do? So next slide, please. So absolutely, this is what you should always do as a matter of best practice, is immediately send out a pre-prepared email to all staff, and please have one ready on your desktop to send, making it very, very clear in simple terms. It's a highly confidential investigation. Please don't take social media, inform nobody outside of the business. This investigation is taking place. You must give accurate and correct information to officers, and absolutely do not destroy any documents, including phone messages, electronic documents, etc., etc. And make it clear that this is a criminal act. And also, if anyone's got any concerns, discuss them with the individual in case. So if you haven't got a prepared email, your external counsel will have a prepared email. So make sure absolutely one goes through. To my view, that is never quite enough. So when you're involved in a debt, you know, certain individuals will have been identified. You must eyeball them. Make it clear, make a note of that, have several witnesses to say, we told them, we made it very clear, and the consequences for them. This is a criminal act, although I have to say, in reality, we're not seeing individuals being prosecuted. We're seeing the companies on the hook for, at the moment, they're quite low fines, but we anticipate that they will get higher and higher. And also there's a reputational aspect. And the other aspect to mention in terms of destruction and tampering with evidence are seals. It's so important that you communicate to SARS that seals must not be broken. In the EU, E.ON was fined £38 million for allegedly breaking a seal. You must make it very, very clear to individuals that seals cannot be broken. And I would actually say, if overnight there's a seal there, we always suggest to the companies, you have a security guard standing there, because you can't always be sure. Absolutely, I would say have a security guard stand there all night. It's not a risk that is worth taking in circumstances.
Great. So, huge amount of information coming over there, but the trigger for this was talking about coming out of COVID, what should businesses be doing? So with that in mind, Sander, what should businesses do? What should in-house laws be doing as we now sort of come out of the hibernation of COVID?
Yeah, as you put it here, embracing the new normal post-lockdown. So in terms of business premises, what we know from time in the trenches is that managing a dawn raid requires teamwork across the business. Now, in the olden days, as I'll call them, that was really quite easy because everyone by and large was in the premises and the people who weren't there, most of the time you knew kind of where they were. So you had a team there and you could work with that, and the business could use that to engage with the CMA. What we're now finding is obviously everyone's embracing hybrid working patterns, and there are situations where people perhaps would normally be in an office in the olden days, now perhaps come once a week, maybe twice a week, maybe not on a Tuesday, maybe they're coming in sort of towards the back end of a week to fit with their own commitments. Who's available to provide IT support? Is that someone on site who in the olden days was always there, now comes in on a temporary basis? If that is the case, can they give IT support remotely? So if the CMA are wanting to access certain things, is there someone who can enable that to happen? We've obviously got a wealth of pre-COVID policies and procedures with companies at the moment. And I think a key question here is looking at those and thinking about teams, teamwork, who's going to be there to form that core team with the various roles delegated. Someone mentioned shadows on a question. Will you have enough shadows on a given day? When you're looking at these policies and procedures, how do they need to be tweaked and refreshed just to reflect these new staff working patterns under the new normal? And if you have new joiners, if there've been internal promotions, departures, where do those sit in contact lists? Because obviously contact lists are only as good as the numbers that are in there. And if those people perhaps aren't there anymore, those numbers become redundant very quickly, and the contact list soon loses the function that it should have, which is when it is a state of extremis, you have a ready to hand list you can quickly work through to disseminate information. So are those things up to speed? And this is all kind of quick wins if you think about it, but it's just the practical aspects that I think need to be just touched on and refreshed. And also external counsel contact lists. Have people moved around the pandemic? Have people moved offices? What are their home working arrangements? That may be a question that's worth having in terms of, can they still provide support that you expect them to on a given day? So those, I think, just tweaks around aspects there. Like another really good question, putting the documents to one side, is whether it's appropriate now to have refresher training about what to do, what not to do, and who to contact. So we've emphasized about not concealing or destroying documentation. If that's in the policies and procedures and people haven't looked at those for perhaps a couple of years, that may not be front and center of their mind. Whereas if you're able to give them an in-house session just to recap some of these key points, that then should bring it back to life for them in terms of taking this opportunity with the new normal to reinstate, to refresh compliance culture within the business. And then thinking about domestic premises, and you know, we have touched upon this in terms of key individuals, and we have emphasised the need for careful messaging around this, but are key individuals aware of the possibility of dorm raids at home? Is this addressed in policies and procedures? Would it be worth giving some refresher training again for that perhaps small group of key individuals to think about, if this did happen in your home, you know, here are some hints, here are some tips, here are some strategies. Because I think what we find in practice is you can give people documentation, and some people are truly diligent and they will read that and think about it. Other people perhaps will just put it to one side and think, I'll turn to that when I need to. And the problem with these sorts of scenarios is when you need it, you usually don't have the time, if you're reading for the first time, to engage with that document. So that refresher training in the background, just to give people a baseline, which can be topped up with a one pager that people can have in their home offices, setting out perhaps some key do's and don'ts around a dorm raid, and also contact details. So they have, again, up to their contact details for people in the office, for external counsel, just so they have that, again, preparing for the worst, not expecting the worst, but just preparing for that. So if something did happen, they would be in a position where they were able to confidently assert what they had to do in the circumstances.
So one thing that's occurred to me is that as an in-house lawyer, obviously let's imagine you're a well-organized company, so you've got your dorm raid policies, you've done your training and done all of that, but actually listening to this, if I was an in-house lawyer, I think I'd want to have some of my own. What do I do in the first 2 hours? Because that's when panic and I can't even think straight. If I've already thought about that in a calm place and got it all set out,
right,
then that will help you be calm at the time, because you can go, oh my God, the worst thing ever is happening. Pull out this document. What to do? First step one, step two. That would be, I think, a really good practical tip, wouldn't it?
I agree, David. And also, if you're doing it in that calm space, you then have the opportunity to think, oh, I've got a question about that. And then you can get in touch with your counsellor, maybe just to check, my understanding is that right? Or should we be doing this slightly differently? That calm space gives you the chance to almost kind of visualise and think about how you engage with it. And I think that does take some of the panic away from what is otherwise a very, very stressful situation.
And all eyes are going to be on you. If you're the senior in house law, I bet all eyes turn, don't they? And if you can do that in a really reassure people and manage it, then you're going to come out well. But if it's flapping around in panic, that's not going to reflect well on you.
I think people also sometimes focus too much on what they're looking at, what they're looking for, what are the buzzwords. Relax on that front, because at the end of the day or at the end of the raid, they will sit down with you and say, right, this is what we're taking. So you will get transparency with respect to that. What you really should be focusing on, as Sam said, is actually the pastoral care issue, calming everybody down, focusing on individuals, and also where is being raided. So make sure there isn't some offshoot, some small subsidiary that is being raided and not getting adequate oversight. And also it's imperative, it's not the crime, it's the cover-up, that you are making sure evidence is secured, because that is really is, I think the most important role you can play as an individual, as an internal counsel, is secure the scene, and afterwards as well, secure the scene.
Now, there's a couple of questions about keeping this in proportion effectively. So are dorm raids, is this only relevant to big companies in markets where they've got big turnovers and market shares?
No, absolutely not. This is something the CMA called the balanced portfolio. They make a point of going after smaller companies as well. They really want the world to know they don't simply just focus on large companies. It is also smaller companies. And there have been a number of investigations where the market cap for the whole of the UK market was £10 million turnover a year for that whole market. So absolutely not. I mean, the numbers of times we've heard we're too small, it's a victimless crime, et cetera, et cetera. No way. It is absolutely no defence to say we're a small company, it's a small market, who cares? The CMA will care.
And I don't know if you know the answer to this question, but somebody asked it. Roughly how many dorm raids a year do the CMA carry out?
Not that many, actually. It's a bit like lightning. When it strikes, it's horrific. I hesitate to say, would it be three times?
I think it depends, because certain investigations, when you look at an investigation, so with the investigation to resale price maintenance into the musical instrument sector, there were a number of cases that came out of that, but that was, at the time, simultaneously organised dorm raids. I think there was perhaps a suspicion this could be an arrangement between competitors rather than individual actors undertaking their own activities. So that was coordinated as a raid. There have been other cases where the case is just one case, but actually the number of raids in the context of that case was maybe 6, 7, 8. So I think it really depends. I think it's hard to say on a given year. I think that the CMA previously has indicated aspirations to open a certain number of investigations in a given year. I think they've now become moved back away from that, but they are still focused upon, you know, seeking infringements, having information on infringements. So this remains a live issue in that context.
Yeah. Also, don't forget, those of you in regulated sectors, the concurrent regulators also have concurrent powers. So Ofgem, for example, has used its powers. So, you know, damned if you do, damned if you don't. So be aware also of those parallel dawn raids as well.
So it's not like there's a dawn raid every day.
No.
So they're not that frequent, but they're unpredictable, and you certainly won't know if your company or your sector is going to be raided tomorrow. You've got no idea. You're not necessarily. There's not going to be any warning signs, are there?
No.
And so, therefore, you need to be prepared. It's like none of us expect our buildings to burn down, but we still have fire extinguishers and fire exits, because if it does happen, it's really bad news. Yeah.
And also, it's a useful tool to have to train people around dawn raids, because it just focuses their minds on day-to-day compliance, because they also want to make sure individuals, we don't want this to happen. They realise the seriousness of a dawn raid and investigation. Therefore, please comply with the rules in the first place, whereby there isn't a danger of having a dawn raid.
Great. I'm going to draw it to a close at that point. I know we haven't answered all of your questions. We've had, I don't know, about 15 questions. I think we've answered about half of them, or about 10 of them. So we will review the questions we haven't answered, and as you think appropriate, we'll be in touch with people on that. But as I said, we will be sending around the slides. There will be the recording as well, which you can review and share as well. Hopefully that has been a useful refresher for all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.